Good night, everybody.
Always wanted to do that.
Hey, say thanks, Steven. Everybody say thanks, Steven. Steven is one of my buddies. He's a very talented actor. He's also from New Orleans. And I got to go do Mardi Gras with those guys this last Mardi Gras, which was amazing. Hi, how's everybody doing? Do I need to ask twice? How's everybody doing? So much better. Who's got a nerd shirt on? That's good. Wow, there's like a whole like grouping. Nice grouping. So this is the second year we're doing Zach's mystery panel. Who's excited for the mystery? It's kind of my favorite thing. The mystery is, it's just me. Let's go. No. Would you guys be okay with that if it was just me? I love you so much. God, I keep forgetting. I love you. I just want you here. I always forget. I get so lost in the moment, I forget all the housekeeping. So, is there flash photography allowed at this panel?
No.
Is there video allowed at this panel?
No.
Do I have very scary but very kind-looking men making sure that you do both of those things?
Yes.
Is there fun allowed at this panel?
Yes,
there is. So here's the thing. Who's been to some panels so far this year? I love you guys. So listen, we have... I'm not really sure. Are we going back to the handhelds? We are handhelds. Okay. So there was some complaints. I was trying to expedite the process of question asking, so we had mics planted all over the audience, but that's not really working out as much as I was about. That's basically what it sounded like. Like, what did that person ask? I couldn't hear. So we have mics here, but this is how question asking is going to go from now on. If you have a question, raise your hand. A volunteer will get you a mic, and the panelists will pick the people who have mics, okay? So if you have a mic and you have a question,
you do this.
And then we'll go, oh, that person has a mic. They can ask a question. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right. What else? Oh, stay seated at the end of the panel. Oh, we're good to go? Okay. Stay seated at the end of the panel. We will usher you out row by row from the back, and you'll have plenty of time to get to know your neighbor. So without further ado, you guys want to meet my mystery panelists? Okay, so this first one, I actually just met him last night. Was anybody partying with us at NerdHQ last night? Yeah. So I just met him last night, and I felt horrible because I've actually not seen his movie yet, which I really, really want to see, but I've been a little busy. But he was totally cool with it. He is actually, he's like, dude, I've seen every episode of Chuck twice. I'm like, you put me to shame. I don't even think I've seen every episode of Chuck twice. But I lived it, bruh. He is such a sweet dude. He is blowing up on the big screen right now. From Pacific Rim, please put your hands together for Rob Kazinsky, everybody. Rob! Hey! Memphis! Say hi to the people. And we're not done. My next two mystery panelists are buddies of mine for a little while, and some of you may or may not know, but because I'm doing a play right now and I gotta conserve my voice, I went to them and I said, hey, will you please help me host this weekend? So the first guy is actually going to be hosting the rest of this day, this very day. And that man is Alan Tudyk. Come through the door. What? Alan Tudyk. Whatever you want. So then, say hi to the. I love you.
Thank you for the hat, too.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah.
You can buy this for, what is it, $50? $50 right outside.
Yeah, something like that.
$50.
Sharpies,
oh, yeah.
In case. It looks like you got a bag of shit.
I got a bag of shit.
Alan's infamous bag of shit, by the way. I mean, maybe you guys have already clued into who my other special mystery guest is, but he's going to be helping me host on Saturday. He's become one of my dearest friends. He's one of the most charming, beautiful, talented men. I hate him so much. That man is Nathan Fillion. Aren't you glad you got tickets?
If I may.
You may.
2013. New venue.
Yeah.
Enormous venue.
Yeah.
Beautiful venue.
Thank you.
Classy. Same chairs.
No, they're different. They're different this year. We had director's chairs last year. We did.
I'm sorry, same chairs as the first year.
There you go. Okay, fine. I'll take that. They're kind of comfy, though. They're a little deep. I never know how to sit in these things. Hey, everybody.
Let's do this. Oh.
This is always a good one. I like this. I like kind of throwing my leg up. Hi, everybody. Hi. Like I said, so if you have questions, make sure you raise your hand to get a microphone. Does anybody have a microphone already? If you have a mic, you do. Red spectacles, buy more. I love you. Come on, nerd herder.
I'm a bit emotional. I just want to cap this off by saying I've had probably one of the worst days of my life. I'm from Australia, and I've had my bag stolen.
Oh.
It's all right. Alan's got a huge bag of shit for you.
So I have no money and no card or anything. I've got to sort that out later. But I'm just very happy that I get to be here and see you
all. Oh, we love you so much. We love you. We're so glad you're here right now.
Angel, what's your name?
Jazz.
You have no money?
No money.
How are you going to eat?
I don't know.
You guys buying her lunch?
I'm going to buy you lunch, I'm going to buy you dinner, and I'm going to buy you breakfast and lunch and dinner tomorrow.
I know this is probably a bit too much. Can I come up and get a hug from all of you?
You know what? At the end of the panel, you are getting a hug from every single one of us. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
Can you feel the love right now? Wow, and that stranger up there just gave you money as well.
I do want to donate some money. I have some British pounds on me, but I just wanted to say I love all of your stuff, as you can probably tell. Just wanted to ask how you really got your breaks in the industry, what your first audition was like, basically.
Oh, that's an excellent question. Gentlemen, would you like to start? Rob?
First off, who sent her the money? Nicest person in the world. My first audition, I don't even remember it.
Or maybe not your first audition. Maybe not your first audition, but what was like your first break? Like what was...
My first break, it came... My first job was actually children's television back in England. I did a show. I don't know if anyone here knows Basil Brush. You're actually English or are you Australian?
I'm half.
Okay, half and half. Like, okay. I auditioned for a children's TV show called Basil Brush Show where I had this long hair. I played a guy called Svengali. I was a very finger to your face bad guy, which I've continued to.
I know!
Which I've continued to play for the next 10 years as well. Can I just say, I was there last time, and I'm sitting here. I'm a brown coat. Any other brown coats? I mean, I'm a massive, massive brown coat, and I'm a massive fan of Chuck. I mean, I'm straight, but I'm probably going to masturbate over this moment.
I was thinking what else I had in there. I was just...
No. Some this, issues.
This day is just full of miracles. Nathan, big break?
I would say I had three breaks. One was my first big job was a soap opera. That kind of got me onto TV. It got me into the United States. I'm Canadian. My second break was I moved to Los Angeles and I was unemployed for a long while. I had a couple jobs right away, but I was unemployed for a long while. I was paying my rent on credit, ooh, right? Waiting for my income tax return to come back to pay off my credit card debt and move back to the soap opera. And I got a job on a sitcom for a couple years, and that, whew, being employed. And then Joss Whedon. I could not get a lead role to save my life until Joss Whedon walked into my life and raised me up. Alan, the wind beneath your wings?
What's that?
Who's the wind beneath your wings?
Oh, the wind beneath my wings. What was that? Would be... It was in theater. It was in New York, a play called Bunny Bunny. And it was about Gilda Radner. And I had left school and, again, was very, very broke. We were going to take the play. We did it out of town in Philadelphia. And we were bringing it back in New York. We couldn't find a theater to do it in. And I was trying to make it as an actor for the first time in my life. Only without waiting tables. And I completely ran out of money. When they said, we can't find the theater, we're gonna have to wait about a year to do this play. And I went downstairs from my building on 10th Avenue between 54th and 55th Street in New York and sat down, had a drink, and the guy was bitching about how they didn't have a bartender. And I was like, I'm a bartender. I can work if you want me. And he was like, okay. You work tonight. And I worked one night in a transvestite bar that served bridge and tunnel transvestites.
If I had a nickel for every time.
And I only worked one shift because it was a dangerous place. I was scared. It stayed open until 4. It was the worst job ever. Oh my God, only one night, it was awful.
Where's the danger? They might try to make you over.
No, there was a guy who had like this leather collar on and... You're hot. I said, okay, what can I get you?
You're hot.
Got that. What can I get you?
You're hot.
All right, I see. And I had to close up at 4 in the morning. There was nobody there but me. Like, anybody could come in. There's money, there's liquor. I mean, it was awful. It was the 90s. It's terrible. So, all right, so this is your question. Okay, so I just want to say right off, my bag of shit has, just like anybody's shit, there's varying degrees of shit. So some of you are gonna be like, oh my God, I want something from that bag. And then sometimes I can give something out and you're gonna be like, that bag sucks. But for you, I just grabbed stuff that I have. This is something that the cast got from Dollhouse. It's like a windbreakery thing, Dollhouse season 2. Wait, what does it say? Oh, it's from Joss, Tim, David, Kelly, and Eliza. Thank you for your hard work and dedication. Don't just go give this away, asshole. All right. Has my address on it. So why don't we all just pass this down and sign it, and we'll just put it over to the side so we don't take up more time, so people can keep asking questions and we can keep moving on.
You can hand that out.
And I put your lunch money in the pocket. Finish the apple.
Wait. Alan, as much as I appreciated your tranny bar story, what was your big break in Hollywood?
Oh, funny enough, it was the guy in the leather collar.
That night I fell in love.
Oh, copy that.
And it led to many things. The next day, after I quit that job, I got a call from the producer of Bunny Bunny, and he said, we found a theater. It was Lucille Lortel Theater on the West Side in the West Village, and we were open. We didn't stay open very long. The play didn't do very well, but I did very well. It was...
You know why?
Why?
You're hot.
Ba-da-bing!
my big break. My first like steady job was a sitcom that I did called Less Than Perfect. I did that for a few years. Wow. Everyone who ever watched the show is in this audience right now. Which was a really fun. I learned a lot. I grew a lot. I came from theater as well. So when you do a multi-camera sitcom, it's very similar. You have a live audience and all that stuff, and it's a lot of fun. Although we stuck around for 4 years, but nobody ever knew who the hell I was from that. That didn't really open a lot of doors. And then I kicked around for a few years, and then Chuck was really kind of like, you know, it's a thing that most people go, oh, that schmuck. I know that guy. He had curlier hair before, didn't he? Shaped like animals. So that was that. And you know, and from that, I've been able to, you know, you just build. You try and get as much stuff as you can. But it's only because of people like yourself who are proud nerd herders who believed in us and who followed us and who care about us and our careers that we even get to do another job. So thank you guys for that. Oh, we got a mic. Yeah, right here.
I have a question for Rob. I wanted to know, how was it playing, going on True Blood and playing Warlow? Because I'm a big fan of True Blood, and I've been watching you.
You've been, you mean on the show? I thought you were just...
No, on the show.
I've been watching you, Rob.
Warlow's a badass character. 6,000 years old, scary. I just hope that people... After being talked about for 2 seasons, people wouldn't be disappointed that he's me and Ginger and English and kind of not as intimidating as everybody was expecting him to be. But I got to play a fairy. Yay! Funnily enough, it's not always been a dream of mine to be a fairy. I did get to also be a vampire, which is cool. Any other True Blood fans here? Hey, very good. It was wonderful. It was great. It was wonderful to be given the reins on something so important.
And this from the shit bag is that is a T-shirt that I got at the Comic-Con in Dubai, which was really a blast. And that was a local artist. They did submissions for certain way to Dubai.
I love that everyone was like, "Ooh, Dubai! I've heard of it." Who's got a mic? Mike, right there, yep.
Hello. Quick question for my friend Kelly, who's watching with the live stream in Ohio.
Hello, Kelly.
Yeah.
Hi.
It's geared more specifically for you, Zach. She was wondering what your experience has been like during this Broadway run with your new show that's just opened.
Yeah.
And wondering if that's something that you want to make more of a bigger part of your career.
The experience thus far, for anybody who doesn't know, I'm doing a new musical on Broadway right now called First Date. And thank you. Wait till you see it before you applaud. No, it's actually a lot of fun. I grew up, like I said, doing a lot of theater, and it's a dream come true to do it on the highest level, and that's Broadway, and it's amazing. And it's really, where did you go? You sat down and I loved, oh, there you are. No, it's okay. It's incredible. I'm so blessed that A, I get to live my dreams. I feel like I've had such a blessed life and I get to continue to check off bucket list items and be on Broadway, originate a Broadway role. And we've, you know, the first week of previews that my producers are gracious enough to let me out of to come and do this. Sorry. We were like, you know, we were selling out and people are just really giving us a lot of love. And I, you know, I mean, actually, Alan and I talked a little bit about our experience or his experience. He's done a couple of Broadway shows and it really is just like the most incredible when you have a live audience, you know, it's it's incredible, you know. So yes, I would love to do... Unless this completely implodes and everyone's like, that Zach should probably stay out of live theater, then yes, I'd like to do more of it. Yeah. And I hope you all come and see the play. If you're ever in New York, for any, I, I've I'm going to say this joke so many times because I love it, but if you wanted a Chuck musical, you have it now because my character is basically Chuck. There's very little difference in that. Which means it's basically me. I'm not really an actor, folks. I'm a liver. Never mind. Who's got a mic?
Great question. There's some Astro Boy shit for you.
Oh,
I did voices in that.
All signed. Yes, you have a mic. Lady in pink.
So I was wondering every one of you, I guess, were a super villain, what villain would you be?
Deadpool. 100%.
Now Deadpool's taken, so what will everybody else choose?
What's that?
I said now Deadpool's been taken, so what will they
Well, do? He was taken by Green Lantern, I mean...
No, I don't mean, like, by an actor in a movie. I mean, you said Deadpool, so...
Oh, yeah. Well, if you guys could be a villain.
Oh.
Oh, here. Send that one.
Rob, if you could be a super villain.
I would love to be Galactus.
It seems so lonely.
No, you're eating whole planets. I got asked this question the other day when I was doing the Anyone See Pacific Rim? Yeah. Doing a press tour for that, and somebody asked me, what battle would you like to see from any kind of comic book villains? And I went, well, Galactus, and there's no one else, really. There's no one that could even come close to beating
lonely.
That guy. Like, not lonely.
Your best friend is like this big.
He's got a little silver man.
He's like forced to be your friend.
I'd be Galactus. I could eat Deadpool.
I would teleport away and slice you with my katana blades.
You said?
I want to see which one you're going to choose because you just told me about one that was really cool the other day.
I don't know what I told you, but here's one. A long time ago when I collected Spider-Man comics, and they were pretty crappy because they're pretty good right now, there was a villain called The Answer. And his ability was that he had the answer to everything. He could fly because he knew how. I wonder where there's some like buried treasure nearby that I could grab pretty easy. I know.
It's a great one.
Is that actually true?
It's true. Do you speak Japanese? Do I speak? Yes, I do. These taxes are, I don't know how to, they're killing me. Let me help.
What was the one you were telling me about the guy who was crazy?
These are all write-offs. Still doing taxes.
I need one more answer. What was the one you were telling me about just 2 days ago about the guy that they're like afraid of and like the UN comes together and they're like, shh, don't say anything.
Oh,
they can hear us.
George Bush.
There's a...
I think it's Barack Obama right now who can hear us. Whoever's in that chair.
You're talking about a comic called Irredeemable where there's a character called the Plutonian who's like super duper, like Superman style.
I want to be him.
And he snaps, and the whole world is at his mercy.
Yep, that one. That one's mine. Thank you for that one.
Who's got a mic?
Oh. Can I just really quickly?
Yeah.
I'm gonna wear these. I'm not giving these away right now, but these were my gloves that I used. If I ever do a talk show, could you come with me? No, it's just you. Please don't pay any attention to me. These are my iRobot gloves. These are my green screen iRobot gloves. Oops, they've got a rip in them.
Now.
Yeah, I just ripped them.
You know I auditioned for that part?
So did I!
Did you remember?
You said that the last time. I was like, I don't remember that. And then I'm like, oh, that's fucking right. Sorry.
I wanted it so bad.
I'm cussing my mind like that.
No, it's
How old right. are you, big guy?
I gotta tell you, there was a role that I wanted.
Little one there. How old is he?
Oh, earmuffs.
Oh, earmuffs.
Where'd my hands go? this is like a machine gun hand now, and this is a huge claw. So it can be anything, right?
I can see it. I can see it.
Right? It's green screen. All right. Here is the shit that you get. It's a good vibes calendar for 2012.
And there you go.
What is good vibes is a cartoon that I'm. There's a cartoon that isn't on anymore, but I was on it. Josh Gad was in it. It's awesome. Awesome. Great.
How are you holding that microphone with a gun? Who's got a mic? Who's got a microphone? Oh, right over there. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I just wanted to thank you guys so much for everything that you do, because you actually... seems sort of weird to say, but you've done a lot for me in my life. Some friends of mine and my sister used to get together to watch Chuck, and sort of that's how I started in the whole comic book and Comic Con sort of realm. And then we started watching Firefly, and that was amazing. So, and then my mom passed away about 5 years ago, and some friends of mine made me watch Death at a Funeral, and it really helped me get through it because it just made me laugh a lot. So,
oh, that's very nice.
Yeah.
And my mom was on a lot of drugs.
Kind of a roundabout way. but anyway, my question is really, Zac, how did you get involved in Operation Smile? And for the other guys, like, are there charities that you're involved in that you really like to help support? And just tell us a little bit about those.
The Op Smile thing, I'll try and be really quick, because I feel like I've said it a lot, and I hate being a broken record, but it's an amazing organization, and you should definitely go onto the website. If you guys haven't already seen, go to operationsmile.org, and you can see everything they do. It was fate. It was God. It was 1 week of just trying to find a charity that I could latch onto, and it could be mine. And five commercials and five billboards in a row later, I said, they're the ones. So that's why. And it's just a powerful, simple thing. It's $240 in 1 hour, and you change a kid's life forever. So that's essentially, you know, four kids per thousand. And, oh, by the way, we all raised $5,000 today, just so you guys know. So... so that's why Op Smile is for me. And what about you guys? Do you have a particular...
Yeah, I'm a patron of Great Ormond Street Hospital in London, which is, if you don't know, is one of the... it's the world's foremost children's hospital, specializing in research for treatment of children. And it's an incredible place. And it's one of only two children's hospitals in England and the only children's hospital in the south of England. And if it didn't exist, we'd be losing a lot more children to a lot more diseases a lot more regularly.
My friend PJ Harsma, who was here last night, was kind enough to let me get involved in Kids Need to Read, just getting books into the hands of kids. Books were a big deal to me growing up, and I think they're an important part of what's going on. And there's that My Charity Water. If anybody follows me on Twitter, I've been connecting with them a couple times. They just make it so easy to help people. Yeah, a dollar at a time. You just take throngs of people and just a little bit. It's amazing, just getting clean water for people just to live. It's fantastic.
I don't really do anything. I give money.
You're doing it now, buddy.
I am. I give money to your thing and to everybody's thing, but I don't have a thing. I mean, I give money to the Institute for the Blind, because that's in my family. That's a thing. But I don't like martial forces. Honestly, listening to you yesterday, Zac, talk about that, and you urged everybody to make your life bigger, it was inspirational. It's inspirational. What you're doing is inspirational. Everything here. You know, this wasn't... you're helping kids, but you're also encouraging and helping wayward actor people to get off their asses and make a difference.
Well, I believe in incentive, man. I think, you know, look, I know you, I mean, we just met last night, but we were like, it's like, hit it off. Like, this is, we're homies. We're already homies. But you know you but what I love and why I'm so excited to have you guys. How excited are you guys to have these guys helping me host this weekend, by the way? I'm so grateful for all the people that have come into my life, like you guys, who I know care about these guys. I know care about interacting with your fans and giving them these special moments. And if we can be incentivized to do that, and they can be incentivized to do that, and we can raise money at the same time, then it's like nobody's losing anything. It's just a win. It's just a win. So thank you guys for being a part of it. Yes, you have a microphone.
So as a brown coat, I have a question for both Nathan and Alan. The first time that you read through the Firefly script, was there a certain line or scene where you felt like you really got the character and you're like, aha, this is somebody I want to play?
First of all, from the person who asked that question before, this is a jacket from Dollhouse. They gave it to the cast. I don't wear it. The scene, when I first got the audition for Firefly, there was no script. There was just this scene mainly of the dinosaurs. My hand is now a dinosaur. The dinosaurs. And that one spoke to me, absolutely. Also the die, the fact that there were no aliens was really appealed to me. Because I wanted to see a space where there are no aliens. I'd never seen that before. It was always lots of makeup and stuff. And there's gonna be a world that was like, no, there's no aliens. We went out there and there was nothing, which was great. What is it? Curse your son. Yeah. And we shall call it this, no, we shall call it this land. We shall call it your grave. Oh! Curse your sudden but inevitable betrayal!
Is anybody coming to the Serenity screening tomorrow night, by the way?
It's gonna be so much fun! We're gonna watch a movie in a baseball stadium.
Do a funny voice, they'll laugh. Who's got a mic?
Nathan has an answer,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, sorry. Duh. We haven't even... Please.
What was the question?
Was there a scene or a line or something that, like, grabbed you when you first read Firefly?
Yes.
Well, and what was it?
The moment... The Mexican standoff between the doctor and the Alliance fella with the gun to Summer's head and... River. Let's call it a river. River's head... And then Malcolm Reynolds just walks in, and when you're expecting a negotiation, all right, or some tough talk, bam, boom, it's done. I was like, wow, that's how it would happen in real life, really, if you think about it. First guy to shoot really kind of wins. That's how I always think about those. Two guys like, you better put your gun down. No, you put yours. One guy just goes, bam, and it's done. I'm always thinking about that. Can't be faster than a bullet. Superman.
So for you, for that question, just so you know what this is, it's a, this was a gift. It's a framed, okay, so this was a pilot that didn't work out. I think that this frame is silver. That's Ty Burrell, who's on Modern Family. He's awesome. Those guys are the guys who created Will and Grace. And that was a cast. I don't think we even had a name.
And other various peoples.
Various peoples. It's called the Untitled. It's like on the subscription says, the Untitled Max Muchnick Project. It's like, the Untitled. It's so...
If need be, that frame can be melted down to kill a werewolf.
Yes. Yes. Probably more useful that way.
In the middle.
Yes, right there.
All right, guys. Zach, you directed... 3 really awesome episodes of Chuck, and I know.
Oh, thank you.
When actors are on shows for long periods of time, especially when they're the title character, they sometimes get a chance to direct. I was really interested in how that came about, whose idea was it, and how was it chosen, which episode you would direct, and then if everyone else would if you want, say, if Zach were to direct you in something, what would you want it to be?
First of all, thank you. I think it was one pretty good episode and two all right episodes that I directed. But it was a tremendous amount of fun. And I've forgotten what the first part of the question was. What was the first part of the question?
How did that come about?
I said, hey, I'd like to direct some episodes. I've always had a passion for directing. I directed a little bit of theater back in the day when I was coming up doing that. And I just, you know, you spend enough time on a set and you see how things happen and how they go. And occasionally I'll be like, I might do it differently if I had the control to do that. And then if you're crazy enough, you go and try and get that control. You know, you try and say, hey, would you entrust me to go and do this? And
what happens when you fail?
You just blame somebody else. That's
nice.
No, that's what a lot of people do. I would never do that. It's like this. It's like HQ. Like I see things sometimes, and I go, if I could do that, how would I do it? And then I just want to go and do it. And it's the same thing with directing. You know, I always kind of view my roles and projects through a director's lens, which is not always the best thing, by the way. Sometimes as an actor, you want to be. Not sometimes, you always want to be very present in your scenes with your other actors. And sometimes when you're constantly thinking about like, oh, this is where the light's coming in, this is where the camera is. And, you know, but we had a crazy schedule on Chuck. So sometimes you only had one take. So we'd have like a guest actor in and they might've been like a little off or they'd be in shadow. And we'd be like doing a scene. I'd be like, oh, and I just kind of move them a little bit and continue. And then we would just keep doing the scene. And, you know, because that was helpful in that moment. But you don't always want to do that. You know what I mean? So that's that. That wasn't a very entertaining or logical answer, but I hope you liked it anyway. And what would you want me to direct you in?
Start with Rob.
This is such a loaded question, by the way. Thanks.
Honest. Bring back Chuck.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll play Baldwin's little brother. Bury me in that.
I can see that.
Best answer ever. And I'll play your sidekick.
No.
Or. You know, I just watched last night, someone tweeted it, and I watched it again. Do you remember that the Trailer Park Heroes you guys did? Those nerd videos you guys do? I'd like to see you direct, and I'd like to do another one of those.
We might do that. You were so good in that. Both of you guys were so good in that.
You were hilarious.
It was very fun. We had a good time. Yeah.
Fumbling with your clips as they're, like, falling out of the gun. And Nathan on a minigun with a lollipop. Or with a, yeah, whatever.
Call what you want.
That was a good time. Good time. I would like for you to direct me in... do like Wash the Early Years, because he's still alive. And you can direct that. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna workshop all this stuff, guys. We're gonna workshop all that. It's coming to theaters near you soon. Who's got a mic?
This can't be signed because we don't have silver pens, but... that's okay. Here's a hat. It's got a lot of my sweat in it. It's Ice Age 2, The Meltdown.
But by the way, remember which one of these are yours.
They're in a line.
Yeah. Oh, there you go.
We're all comfortable with the honor system here.
Yeah,
no fighting.
Soups, hit me.
Hello, gentlemen. Nathan, you were talking about the importance of reading. My mom's a librarian, and it got me thinking. You guys have played characters that you see people cosplaying at the convention center. Obviously, these have had an impact on your audiences. What's one... assassin out of nowhere.
Ask and you shall receive.
Be careful what you ask for.
Yeah, man, if only there was $1 million on stage right now.
I don't have any throwing stars.
Oh, no.
I'm sorry, you were interrupted. Continue,
please. I think this is the part where I'm supposed to wish for, like, Chuck Firefly and all the other shows to come back. And,
right.
No, the characters that influenced you, the one character when you were growing up saying, wow, I really wish that I could be like, I could play this character, I could be more like this character.
Excellent question.
From a book? Or
that I'm going to answer like...
Book or movie, honestly.
Excellent. I'm going to answer it like this. Because I'm Canadian, and it's all kind of a North American kind of thing going on with Americans, I grew up with the same kind of cultural references you guys did, so I don't think anything's going to be a big surprise. Rob, where did you grow up?
London.
What were your like kind of things that you grew up going, oh man, that's it?
To be honest, I was only ever really allowed to play with matches.
Allowed?
Well, we didn't really...
Wait, son, here. Let me just soak you in this gasoline first.
I mean, I went out my way. I was unlike most kids. I was a comic book kid. You know, I collected all my X-Men, and I was always into comic books, and I was massively into Star Trek. I know there's Star Wars, Star Trek, but I have actual outfits. I have original artwork from the original movies from Japan, actually. I have trading cards. I have the whole thing. So Star Trek was probably my thing. I always wanted to be in science fiction. I'm a massive Isaac Asimov fan, a massive fantasy fan. I read a lot of R.A. Salvatore, David Gemmell, Eddings. I mean, I'm into all those guys.
Did you look at Kirk and go, I could do that?
I think everyone did.
Yeah, right?
But as
you
a character...
Zach? I didn't.
What? No,
look at Kirk and do that. Am I the only one up here?
No, I didn't. Yeah, I wasn't. No, I didn't. I think you and
guys.
I...
You guys have actually piloted spaceships, though. I mean, you've been in spaceships.
Yeah, I flew a spaceship.
That's cool.
I did. So I looked at Sulu and went, I could do that. I could do that.
Oh, my.
I think if I had to say there was one character I wanted to play, is anyone familiar with Forgotten Realms? Three people. Good. R.A. Salvatore writes this character, Driss Stewarden. I can fight with two swords. I'm actually, I was a sword master. I trained with swords for years, so I would like to do that if they ever did a film.
Very cool.
Rob, your nerd cred is blowing me away right now. I can't even...
I wasn't lying.
No,
I am a full-on...
No, yeah, I love it.
Nerd
cred. Yeah. One of us. One of us.
What about you, Karen?
Kind of like stretching off into like Renaissance man genius level, though. Like,
yes, of course, I was a swords master, yeah. So you know,
we've all bought a katana off of Amazon in case of a zombie apocalypse, but sword master, nicely done. Harrison Ford was the guy for me because. We were visiting relatives south of Boston. My parents ditched all the kids at the movie theater. Said, here's a ticket. Good. Number four. See you guys later. And I don't care about that. I don't know what this is. Oh, my God. The first hero I'd ever seen that wasn't completely prepared for everything. He got his ass kicked all the time. And he was just, I loved it. Loved it. And he had a hat, so.
Cool. Gene Wilder. Anything Gene Wilder did, I was into. Which I know that you almost did the musical of Young Frankenstein.
Of Young Frankenstein, yeah.
That was my favorite movie. I like that. I just rewatched. They just showed it at the ArcLight. That movie holds up. It's so incredible. But yeah, not so actiony, more hysterically strange. That's what appealed to me. Surprisingly. Does that answer the question? This is a Good Vibes t-shirt. It's more Good Vibes swag. Great cartoon if you haven't seen it. I don't know where you can.
I concur. I concur with both those. I think Harrison Ford, Han and Indy are two of the most iconic characters that we could ever all grow up with. And Gene Wilder to me is just like incredible. And everything that he's ever done, he's so talented. But also, I mean, I'm a big Tom Hanks guy because I just always felt like he was kind of like, I also love like Jimmy Stewart's, like I've always just loved the everyman. I've always loved the guy that you can always just be like, I know him, and I like him, and I root for him, and he speaks for me in whatever he does in those roles, and I feel like Tom Hanks is one of those guys. And I remember when I saw Forrest Gump for the first time, I was like 12 or so, we were on vacation. We went to the movie theater, we saw the movie, and I started crying. It was the first movie I ever cried at, and I didn't just cry. I mean, I cried. I ugly cried. It was like, it was weeping. Like, and there was still like half a movie, half an hour of the movie left. To the point where my parents and the people around us were like, "What are you beating him? Like, what is going on with your child?" But to me, it was so beautiful because I was like, I want him to be real. I want this guy. This guy is the purest. Like, yeah, he's not a. He's better than everybody because he's not jaded and he hasn't hurt anyone and he doesn't lie to anyone and there's no guile. And I just like, oh man, I wish that guy was real. I wish that I could go to him and say, I love you and hug you and say, I wish, you know.
Mow my lawn.
Mow my lawn, man. Loved it. My flex.
Let's go for a run.
Pong paddle. Oh, I need to sign that. Who's got a mic? Right there.
Oh, hi. Oh, I love you, all of you guys.
We love you too.
Chuck, I love Firefly, Castle, all of it. My question is, of everything in here, I haven't seen Pacific Rim yet, but I will, I promise.
That's all right, please. I haven't either.
Okay. Anyway, everything in your entire careers, what was your favorite scene to film? And Zach, before you tell me, can you give me the smolder, please? Thank you.
You're welcome. God, it's amazing. The little things in life. It's amazing. You guys.
Rob, start.
I know you haven't seen Pacific Rim, but there was a fight sequence I had in there with Charlie Hunnam. Yeah. And,
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And he actually, we went through that. There was 3 days of really hard fighting, and he broke my nose in the middle of a shot. It's actually on screen and everything like that. Great. There's a great shot where he's meant to step up on me, swing his leg around, take me down an armbar, but he actually kicked me in the face with an iron-tipped boot.
True.
And I didn't go down.
Thanks a lot.
That was probably the most fun I've ever had because I little known fact, I actually trained as a stuntman before I became an actor. So...
Oh, did you? The last panel I have, Rob.
So being able to actually do a stunt in a fight was pretty much a dream come true.
That's awesome.
Rob's resume is a 3-ring binder. One of those big ones.
I got nothing.
I'm going to update it for him, make it a PowerPoint presentation. Lots of explosions. I saw that fight you're talking about. I literally leaned to my friend in the middle of it and said, that hurt. I saw it twice. I said, ooh, he's feeling that in the morning. I'm sure of that. Alan, you're next.
When I saw that fight, my friend leaned right over to me and he said, that hurt. Yep. I don't remember the question. What was the best...
Favorite thing to film.
Oh, favorite thing to film. There was a makeout scene I had with Gina Torres. Not gonna tell you which one. But we really became friends that day. In a very platonic way. I'm thinking of Gina Torres because of this. This is your whoever your thing. This is a picture of us as kids on a dinosaur. That's some art that somebody gave me. Favorite thing to film? Shit, I don't know. I don't know.
I got one.
Yes.
You were there. We were. I just remembered this. I had such a good time. You know how you kind of, you have to collaborate. You have to kind of come together. How is this going to, what would be the best way to, and we were crashing in a spaceship, something that none of us have ever done. So we had to kind of look at each other and go, so we should all kind of crash in the same way, right? Because we're all in the same crash. What do you? And we kind of worked out a thing that hit and kind of threw us up, and we're all kind of going, whoa, like we're all kind of weightless for a second before we come down again, and it hurts like hell, and it's like the second bounce is what we kind of came to. Do you remember that? The whole thing where we were all strapped in the bridge? It was right before... It was right before you said that amazing line.
If you've forgotten, we're going to refresh you on Saturday night.
My script only went up to a certain page number. I don't remember. This should be the gift I gave you on this. All my friends are dead. A fan actually gave me that in Sydney. you're dead. That was fun. That was a lot of fun. I don't know. That's sad. I don't know. There's things I like that I watched, but I didn't like to film. There's a lot of things I like that I've seen, but in filming them, they were very difficult. Death at a Funeral was very hard to film, but I like how it turned out.
Yeah, Death at a Funeral, you in the bathroom eating the cold cream.
Oh yeah,
remember that?
Which isn't in the movie. It didn't make it into the movie, but we talked about it before we left, and there was a great bit. Was that yours? It was. Was the eating it?
Your bit.
That was
your...
my bit.
He takes cold cream and he eats it. He goes.
That's how you know we worked on it, because it never made it in the movie, but we were working on it before I left town.
I loved you in 28 Days. That's the first thing
fun.
I ever saw
you know
in.
What? That was
and
fun.
I think when I first met you, I totally geeked out on you. I was like, you remember 28 Days when you and you're doing like your like to camera. You're
oh,
talking
yes.
about like
you know what?
It's like a yeah. like a big serving spoon, like a ladle, Or when you're dangling in your harness and you're like, look at my package right now.
That was fun. Those were all improvs. That was all like Betty Thomas let us just do improv, and she was like, how did you come to rehab? Because we were all in rehab, and I had this whole thing that they had already filmed on the monologue about how I'm a fish, I'm like fish, I am Pisces, and so I'm a fish. It's gone.
Gone.
I'm a fish and I swim upstream. I want to be lazy and swim down the river, but I have to swim upstream to be sober and to see Mr. Fly Fisherman to say, have some bait, have some sex and some crack cocaine, but I have to say no and swim around him and jump to spawn because the bear is there to say to have him some meals. And I'm jumping to swim, and there's a whole thing about swimming, and we shot it, and then she came back, she's like, there's a flare in the camera, so we can't use it, so we gotta redo it. And I redid it, and it just wasn't, because I had made it up when we did it, it was just kind of improv'd, and so I finished it, and I didn't realize there was a picture of a broken heart behind me, and she goes, hey, can we just do one more? Gerhardt, tell me about, you just had a breakup. And I had actually was going through a breakup at the time. And that's me describing my breakup. Yeah.
Otherwise known as cheating.
No, if really you know the monologue, it's what it was. It was, we were at a fork in the road, but it was more like she didn't see it as a fork. She was happy where she was, but I had to go to the larger fork, like she was on a shrimp fork or a crab fork. And I needed like a large serving fork. So that was the destruction of my relationship, and we laugh about it. Like, longest answer here today.
We are unfortunately
because Alan talked a long time.
No. No what?
I have one more gift. Is there one more question?
Yeah, we got. No. We can do. I'm gonna do one more quick question. Yes, you have a mic right here. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Yes, one more, real quick.
Okay, so I'm a
love
huge,
a shirt.
Thank you. I'm a huge gamer. Loved Wreck-It Ralph.
Right.
I know that I've heard that voice before that you did, but I don't know where I heard it from. How did you, like, I didn't even know it was you when I was watching it as your rummaging around. how did, what was your creative process in coming up with the voice for King Candy? Were you like directed, or was it just something you just kind of like, oh, I'm just gonna make this loose and whatever?
Yeah.
Rummaging.
Well, here's how it went.
Thanks, buddy.
First of all, this is a coat that Russell Crowe gave me.
Oh, my God.
Actually, Russell Crowe and Christian Bale bought.
What?
For 310 to Yuma, it was a gift for, it was like a duster. It's like this heavy, oiled cattle jacket, which
okay
I'm never going to wear.
I'm okay.
And it just sits in my closet heavy, but it's a brown coat.
Yes.
So I figure it's like a brown coat, right? So take it. I think it was expensive.
Yeah.
Obviously, don't give me gifts.
Okay.
I don't care.
Did you get inspiration for King Candy from
Edwin?
Edwin.
That's where I was.
Matt Hatter. You're so good.
Well, they said.
He really is so good. I mean, honestly.
There's nothing they said. Somebody else was supposed to read the role for the read through at Pixar. Whoever that person was fell out and they needed somebody to do the read through. So my agent said, Alan can do it. And they're like, can he do like an Ed Wynn type voice? And she's like, Alan can absolutely do that. And they said, great, then bring him along. And then she called me, she's like, Alan, can you do that voice?
I don't know, let me try.
And YouTubed him real quick, and he had a show. He had the Ed Wynn show, and he's come out, and he has a laugh. He had a little hat, and he had a little lisp. But he was a wonderful man. And I went up to Pixar and did the read-through, and after the read-through, John Lasseter came up and put his arm around me. It's like, it's good to meet you. I was like, oh!
You're hot. And that's it, everybody. Rob Kazinsky, Nathan Fillion, Alan Tudyk. Let's take a picture. Give it up. If you had a question, if one of these is yours, stick around toward the end. Our volunteers will help you. Stay seated. Get out of here. Huh? What? Oh my God, your hug. Come here right now. Better yet, come find us in the concourse, okay? Yeah. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Wait, say that again. Everybody got that? If you guys got one of these wonderful bag-o stuff, gifts, just stick around just a little bit after everybody's all out. Sound good? Was that fun? Aren't these guys so much fun? They're so good. All right.
Thank you, Zach.
Oh, my pleasure. I love you guys. You make being an actor and an entertainer worth it. You make it worth every second of it. So thank you guys so much. And thank you for being a part of what we do here. And thank you for raising so much money for kids. You guys are changing lives all over the world, and you should know that. And it's much, much appreciated. So I love you and thank you so much. And I'm going to go save my voice now. And I hope I see you guys at NerdHQ all weekend long, okay? Bye.